You sliced us up some apples too, didn't you?
So I would wait, because like right now I only have a couple people who are here with us, and we have 18 people coming. So you could wait a little bit, and then when it's, you know, when Laura introduces you, gives you a proper introduction, then we can, you know, then you can, they're so cute. Then we can do, you know, you can talk more about them. I'm sure she's going to invite you.
Okay. All right. So am I supposed to hang up now? Or?
No, I wouldn't hang up. If you want to, though, just show yourself and don't show the other people. You know, our special guests.
Our special guests.
Yes.
The camel
is.
So
it's kind of a surprise.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
All right.
You'll never admit it. You had seen it last time, and now I don't get seeing it because you didn't write down the password.
So, Doris, are you getting connected? All right.
Your phone's still on. Hello?
We can continue to talk for a while. You know, because I have people signing in, so.
Okay.
I mean, we can just.
Why don't you have a little chat with Robin here?
Yeah. Hi there. Here. And I see Marianne with us. That's good. Good.
I can hear you.
Good. That's great. And Jim, you can hear us as well? Okay, perfect. All right. Good.
Hi.
Hello.
Oops, there's somebody coming. I'm not quite sure, Doris. I'm seeing your name several times and there's some feedback, like some squealing. Do you think, are you on your computer and your phone, or I'm not sure. Okay. There you are, Laura.
Hi.
Great. Okay.
Okay, so I guess I can't do this.
I suppose, I'm thinking about the feedback that I'm getting. So I'm supposing that when I mute everybody, then that will go away. That's what I'm hoping. So that we don't have feedback, okay? All right. Okay, we got a couple minutes here. We're supposed to have 18 people come, and so far there are, I think, 12. So we'll wait just a few minutes before we get our program started.
Come on, Chewy. I don't know if they can see or not.
Yes, we're seeing. Yes, we are.
Can you see the llama and Billy?
Well, we're seeing your husband, but you have to move a little to the right, I guess, to see. There we go. Now we're seeing the star.
There he is. Hi, buddy. Hi. Oh, he loves his apples. Wait a minute. You can't have them all. Oh, here's everybody now. They all ran up.
I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, this is a new thing for some of them.
Yes.
They don't always love apples, but I think they do now.
Yeah, the last guest.
Tried celery and apparently it wasn't a big hit.
All right. So Laura, it's 6:30. Do you want me to run our 5-minute thing then? Okay. All right. So I'm going to mute everybody and we're going to sort of deviate from my normal introductions and I'm going to play something for you while other people join us. All right. Let's see here. Oh, wait a minute. Okay. Okay, no, wait. Oh boy. Now I'm in trouble. Because I have to go back to this. Okay, I forgot to share my own screen. There it is. Okay. Now I think we're good.
This land is your land. This land is my land. From California to the New York Islands, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me.
I've traveled every road in this here land. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Reno, Chicago, Fargo, Minnesota, Buffalo, Toronto, Winslow, Sarasota, Wichita, Tulsa, Ottawa, Oklahoma, Tampa, Panama, Mattawa, La Paloma, Bangor, Baltimore, Salvador, Amarillo, Tocopilla, Barranquilla, and Padilla. I'm a killer. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. been to Boston, Charleston, Dayton, Louisiana, Washington, Houston, Kingston, Texas, County, Monterey, Faraday, Santa Fe, Tallapoosa, Glen Rock, Black Rock, Little Rock, Oskaloosa, Tennessee, Tennessee, Chicopee, Spirit Lake, Grand Lake, Devil's Lake, Crater Lake, Beach Lake. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the desert, bare man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Of travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Louisville, Nashville, Knoxville, Ombabaka, Shepherdville, Jacksonville, Waterville, Coast, Rocket, Pittsfield, Springfield, Bakersfield, Shreveport, Hackensack, Cadillac, Fond du Lac, Davenport, Idaho, Jellico, Argentina, Diamantina, Pasadena, Catalina, Sea, Guatemala. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I've traveled, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Pittsburgh, Parkersburg, Gravelburg, Colorado, Ellensburg, Rexburg, Vicksburg, Eldorado, Larimore, Atmore, Havistraw, Chattanooga, Chaska, Nebraska, Alaska, Opelika, Baraboo, Waterloo, Kalamazoo, Kansas City, Sioux City, Cedar City, Dodge City, what a pity. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the desert, bare man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I've traveled, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been everywhere.
All right. I hope that's not on a loop, is it?
Should not.
No. Okay, great. All right. So it looks like everybody's here that's coming. So now I will introduce myself. My name is Cheryl Rigger and I work for the Dover Public Library. I want to thank everybody for coming. We're in for a special treat. And I'll let you discover that as we go along. I just needed to tell you that I am recording the program this evening and it will be available in our library archives for 1 month after, probably tomorrow when we get it uploaded. You can always check out the programs that we have coming up at the library on our website, on our Facebook page. And of course, if you go into the library, we have flyers that we have to give out to remind you. And we also have posters and there's always a press release. So you can, there are lots of ways to figure out what is enticing you to join us at the Dover Public Library. So this evening, like I said, we're in for a real treat here tonight. I actually usually introduce the speaker myself, but tonight the speaker is going to introduce herself in a very special way and some special friends that she has with her. So I'm turning the program over to Laura Watilo Blake. She is a photojournalist and world traveler. During these pandemic times. Well, maybe she's not a world traveler, but she certainly is. The program tonight is aptly called The Return to America. So thanks everybody for coming. And Laura, thank you for coming as well. It's up to you now.
Thank you very much, Cheryl. I'm really excited to be here. I wasn't sure I was gonna be in this room. I was planning to be somewhere else. And then at the last minute, I had to rush back. But I am going to just share my screen really quick to get the presentation started. And here we go. Can everyone see my screen?
Yeah, I can, yes.
Everybody's nodding, thumbs up, okay. So I wanted to start by, I see I've already messed up. I wanted to start by telling you a little bit about me. I am an obsessed traveler. I don't know, show of hands, how many other obsessed travelers are out there? Obsessed armchair travelers? Either way, I am an obsessed traveler who turned my love of travel into a career. I'm a professional travel writer and photographer. Photography is my first love, but then I kind of learned how to write in journalism school and so that I could do both. And it has been a really, really amazing career. I have the best job in the world. That's what I like to tell everybody because it's true. I live in Ohio. I'm from Cleveland. I am the author of Ohio, A Photographic Journey, which is available on Amazon. I also do documentary filmmaking and I have a film that played in the Cleveland International Film Festival a couple years ago, and now there's going to be a re-release coming up this year, which I'm very excited about. And I am the proud mother of a little traveler. She's 7, and she's kind of taken up a love of travel just like I have, thank goodness. I was a little worried she was going to be stuck in her ways and not want to go anywhere, but luckily she loves to go. So let's see. So where am I today? I am not in Ohio. I am in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And while I'm here, I paid a visit to the Enchanted Yurt and Llama Ranch. It's owned by Bill and Robin Spencer. And they also run Santa Fe's only roller rink, which is pretty cool. I made a little video to introduce them, and I thought I'd play that right now. So give me just a second.
There was a llama farm close to where we lived in Boulder, Colorado. And I liked them, but I got to admit, I'd never really had an ambition to adopt any at that point in my life. But when we moved here and we were looking for a place to live, one of the things Robin insisted on was a place where we could have llamas.
Yes, this is Ami Lami. This is Jangles.
Hi, Jangles.
This is Galaxy.
Come on, girl.
Come on, girl. You can get it. And there we have, in the background, we have Dumplin.
This is the yurt inside.
What was
this
for? We've
been into Mass a long time before the pandemic. Here we go.
Hi, sweetie.
I was totally ready.
I want to introduce Bill and Robin right now. They are on mute, so hopefully we can get them unmuted and they can introduce you to their llamas, and then we'll continue our presentation. Just a moment.
So will, do they know how to unmute themselves, or do I have to do that?
If you can do it, that might be helpful.
Well, let's see if I can. I think it says here, ask them to unmute.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, it came up.
Now we can hear. Great. Thank you.
Yep. Hi.
Let's see if we can get these characters in the background. Oh, where are you? Here.
There we go. There he is.
Here, we're going to give him a little carrot for you here. Oh, boy.
Oh, it's better.
Oh, nice. So we've had this family of llamas together since probably 2001. And there are many,
actually it was 2000.
Many generations have been born here. Here's the littlest one. He's Bojangles. Let's see where some other ones are. Yep. Who else is around here?
Got Dumplin there on the right, their mother, eating a tumbleweed. They find tumbleweeds very delicious. And the interesting thing about weeds is they don't like to eat them when they're still green. They wait until they're all dry and brown, and then I think they get more of the nutrition because they've fully ripened, just like we do with wheat or the weeds that we eat.
They're like toothpicks. They're all crunchy, like pretzels.
You have a fan there.
Yeah, you are the star today, aren't
yes,
you?
Yes, he really likes these things. He's well, just discovered.
Robin, I learned something from you the other day when I was visiting. I learned that these creatures are related to another animal that lives in the Southwest from way back when. So, Bill, can you describe that for us?
Yeah, well, actually, way back in the around the second ice age, we wound up with all of these juniper bushes and trees spreading out throughout the area, and a certain small four-legged rodent that we're all familiar with called the rabbit discovered some of them discovered that they rather liked eating leaves and branches, and they wound up gradually over generations, one generation stretching higher than the next to get it leaves and branches on trees. The shape of their legs changed. They kept their claws, but they only kept two toes, and then that's what gives them their two-toed feet. Here you can see that. Can you see the feet there? You know, but they're, you know, if you see them next to a rabbit, you can see the resemblance because they have the ears. But note that rabbits come in two sizes. Llamas come in two sizes. You got your alpaca. You've got your llamas, of course. And they wind up being the thing that's interesting is that what made llamas, just like domestic rabbits, what made llamas have their colors and different patterns is the fact that, number one, I think it made it more attractive to humans, and humans represent protection from predators. They're in South America, they have the pumas. Here we have mountain lions, which were their original enemy. But when humans came, the humans that are first arrived in the Southwest where they first developed, they kind of killed them all off. So they became extinct in this area around 10,000 years ago, about 3,000 years after the arrival of humans in the neighborhood. And the ones that survived were the ones that went across into South America when they migrated south. And the ones that migrated west went up and over the Bering Straits and became camels. And camels too come in two sizes. So they're just like, you know, the bunny and the jackrabbit and the two different size camels and the two different size camelids, both wild and tame. But the tame ones change colors because I think it makes them more attractive to humans, and they don't need to hide, you know, and fit in the way that, wild rabbits and wild camelids do, which are generally kind of a brown kind of antelope looking critter.
Bill.
Yes, ma'am.
When you stay there, the yurt is just a few feet away from the llamas. Do the llamas wake up people that are sleeping in the yurt nearby?
No, usually people wake up and they look out and they see the llamas. There's something very comforting and wonderful about looking out and seeing these guys just playing. They're very quiet most of the time. They do have voices. They make some very interesting sounds. One I like to call the Angry Donald Duck, which sounds like Donald Duck having a hissy fit. And it sounds a little bit like this. Here, I'll do my imitation. It was like that. They make a sound like that that I find amusing. But they also make little verbalizations. They're fairly vocal with one another, especially when it comes to food and each other's territorial imperatives, or if a young one is hungry, they're more than happy to speak up and talk to the mom and let them know that maybe it's dinner time. They have very small udders, so they only have, maybe 6 ounces of milk, which means they nurse off and on regularly when they're young, and they take to eating pretty quick. And after they're born, of course, the mothers don't really clean them up the way some animal mothers do. But Chewy's being very, very verbal here. I'll show you what he sounds like here.
So how can people find you if they want to stay on your llama farm and spend the night in the yurt?
Well, we have, it's the Enchanted Yurt and Llama Ranch. And it's on Airbnb, and we've been on air. I built the yurt some 14 years ago, and when we discovered Airbnb, we found that people loved being here because you get to be so close to these guys. Oh, here we go. We're having a little. The wind caught the tumbleweed here.
They're so fun when they run. They love to chase up and down. That's why we called Jangles when he was born. As soon as he could start walking and getting around, he would just playfully nudge, the bigger ones and dance around.
Yeah, he likes to bang into his sister. I call that jangling.
Mr. Bojangles from the song.
Yeah, and he also, the Princess Amidala there, Ami Lami, and Valentine, and Dumplin, Jangles' older sister, and Jangles himself are big dancers. When it comes to feeding time, they do the cutest little kind of dancing, and they kick their legs up in the air, and they get all excited. They're not afraid to show their enthusiasm.
We've seen them on the full moon for sure. Here's Chewy again. He's got something to say.
Here.
Chewy, do you have something to say to the folks? Yeah. Do you love your life? Yeah.
He says, I'd like to be over there with those guys.
Will you sing a little song for us?
See, they're
very good.
Very good. You got to hear them.
Well, Bill, thank you very much. Bill and Robin, thank you very much for introducing us to your llamas. If you want to stick around for the hour at the end, if anybody has any questions for you,
you
can have some questions.
Sure.
All right. Well, we'll see you a little bit later.
All right. Great. Thanks.
Hi. Come visit.
Isn't that kind of fun to be able to travel without leaving your chair at home? It's kind of nice. I'm going to see if we can mute from here. Maybe Cheryl can do that. There.
I'm looking to see, and I don't see when I put my hover over it. Oh, there it is. Okay. I think we did now.
Okay. So I'll go back to sharing my presentation.
Okay.
Let's see where it is. Anyway, it was so fun to find them, and I'm staying in another apartment in Santa Fe while I'm here, but they are literally only like an 8-minute drive away. I was going to present from there today, but their bandwidth wasn't so good on the property. So I decided to come back here to make it easier on everybody. Let me see. Oh, here we go. And we're back. Back to the regularly scheduled program. Oh, I don't think I shared sound. Hang on a second. Okay. Okay. Yep, I did. Okay, anyway, so back to the presentation. Had fun. My daughter didn't quite love roller skating, but we still had fun when we went out to their roller skating rink on Friday nights. So that's kind of a benefit for people who stay there. Okay, let's see. Well, I don't know if anybody of you have been to Santa Fe, but there's kind of two sides to Santa Fe. There's the side that caters to the very wealthy celebrity folks, and then there's the real side of Santa Fe. And after I've been here so many times in the last 20 years, I kind of seek out those other more unique experiences. And I thought that would be a fun thing to do. So how many of you have now been vaccinated? Some of you are on, have your videos on, but if you show of hands, has anybody been vaccinated? Oh, yay. I'm halfway there. Oh, good. Yeah, so, and I'm sure, you know, we're still supposed to wear our masks and stay socially distant, but now we're kind of trying to get out of our pandemic bubble and try to reach out, you know, and go out and see things and do things finally. So in this presentation, I have a little information about should I stay or should I go? What kinds of trips are safe to take in 2021? And then I'm going to share some photos from my pandemic road trip. And then I have more tips for an epic US road trip. And then places you love close to home. I know a lot of you are in Ohio, and there's a lot of great things in Ohio that I can share as well. And we'll see how much time we have. And let's just move on. Should I stay or should So as you know, I'm in New Mexico, so this is Chimayo. Should you travel right now? And the answer is maybe. There are a lot of factors that weigh on your decision whether to go. It depends on your comfort level and overall health. It depends on what kind of traveler you are and how well you can adapt to like the new normal of travel. And it also depends on what is open and what is not. For example, I'm currently in New Mexico, which took swift action last summer to curb COVID infections, including shutting down visits from out of state. Like if I wanted to go camping, I could not go into a state park. They would not let me in, and I'd have to quarantine for 2 weeks. So I have family here and I was not able to come. So we kind of shifted our schedule around to not come to New Mexico, but New Mexico has opened now, but there are still things that are closed. For example, this is one of my favorite places to go in New Mexico. It's Caxacatui Tent Rocks. It's on the Cochiti Pueblo, on Pueblo lands. And it's still closed. Like I drive by because my sister lives on Cochiti Pueblo in the town of Cochiti. And we pass right by it every time I go visit her, and it's still, the sign's still up. It's closed, closed, closed. So I'm looking forward to a time when we can get back to the places we love. But, you know, it's still not perfect right now. So would you rather wear a mask or no mask? As of March 26, 2021, a few days ago, several states don't require a mask. Florida, Texas, Wyoming, and Arizona. That's not the kind of place that I want to be visiting personally right now, given that they're not paying attention to mask rules. I mean, a lot of people are still wearing their masks, but I would kind of look at regulations in each state before you decide to go somewhere. So yeah, wear the mask. How about this? Would you rather go on a river cruise or hire your own boat and cruise the river? This is in the Wisconsin Dells. This was last summer. We rented our own boat. So this pontoon shows is a shown here, but we rented a small speedboat and we cruised along the river at our own pace. We ordered food from a dock and dine location down the river, and then just took our boat and beached it on a private beach and had a picnic. I mean, to me, you're not going to get that on that experience on a sightseeing cruise. So even though you might have chosen a sightseeing cruise in the past, maybe there are other things that you can do. How about, would you rather eat in a crowded restaurant, or are you willing to give up the atmosphere of the restaurant for a picnic? And of course, we chose picnicking. I have a friend who plans a trip to the Jersey Shore every year, and he was telling me recently that he wasn't going to go this year because he wanted to eat out at restaurants and have that full experience. But I still think that you can have a great experience doing takeout or eating on a patio. How about this? Would you rather stay in the swanky urban hotel or spend the night under the stars? I bet a lot of you will probably choose lay hotels. I'm a camper. I also like cabins. And so to me, a cabin strikes the perfect balance of comfort, scenery, seclusion. They have all the comforts of a hotel, often with more amenities such as a kitchen, separate living spaces. And this is in Custer State Park, and it feels like a campground. It has fire pits and it has a picnic table, but then you have the bathroom and bed, plus no one's coming to your door. They won't clean the rooms as of right now while you're still in it. They wait for you to exit. So you're not gonna have anybody coming to your door, which is very nice, and it reduces the number of touch points with other people. So you'll find state parks and national parks, they all have cabins. And so most of our trips in the last year has involved a combination of cabins and camping. And I might even consider a motel, although I generally don't, but a motel has its own door and no one else is coming in. So what kind of trips can you expect to bounce back the quickest this year? Day trips will continue to be a great way to get outside. We are so lucky in Ohio to have all these great places around us, such as the Hocking Hills. That's one of the most popular state parks. The park, Hocking Hills State Park, spent the entire closure last year, and they used that time to reroute some of the trails so that you only go in one way and come out the other way. So that was a huge benefit to anybody who came to the park after they reopened. So that was a smart move. And those of you in the Dover area have lots of options close to home because you're in Amish country and the wineries are on your doorstep. So that's kind of nice. And there's Amish country. So the second thing that's happening is a vaxication. Has anybody heard of a vaxication? It's basically people are starting to plan their trips based on the fact that they've gotten both vaccinations, or the one if you have the Johnson & Johnson. But you know, there's still a catch. Vaccinations doesn't make the hassles of traveling during the pandemic disappear because of the surges in the variants. The CDC is still encouraging people not to travel so much and travel farther afield. So if you're gonna make plans for a big vaccination and your big bucket list trip, you're looking at past fall before those things are gonna start picking up, but they are kind of happening. Home away from home, renting I don't know how many of you have done an Airbnb rental before. You can raise your hands if you have. Yeah, they're really nice, a great place to find a private home. You can search different things. Like I always look for a hot tub because if you're not going anywhere and you just want to change the scenery, I look for a hot tub for sure. And maybe a fireplace, as you can see here. So Airbnb, VRBO, and hipcamp.com are great ways to find these unique homes all over the country. This one, you know, you don't have to go that far away. Salt Fork State Park in Ohio and Cambridge has hot tubs, which I didn't realize until this year. So I was very excited about that. Another thing that's really big this year is outdoor adventures, kayaking, hiking, rock climbing. My daughter's really taken to rock climbing. RVing. Anybody here have an RV? Anybody? I don't have one. So a lot of people were looking for RVs in the last year. And if you don't have one, you can rent one. Outdoorsy.com, RV Share, and Cruise America are good places to start looking for a rental of an RV. The prices vary, but they can cost around $250 a day. And while I love the idea of toting everything with me, I couldn't justify the cost of $250 when I could get a very nice hotel for the same amount, or an entire home for the same amount per day. So I never went that route. And this leads me to the number one travel trend in the US for this year, and that is the road trip. That's why we're here tonight. So whether you have an RV or not, road trips are the go-to. So last summer, when we were wanting to get out, everything was sold out. I was on Amazon, I would go look in Target. First it was toilet paper that disappeared and paper towels. And then it was bikes. Bikes were flying off the shelf for everybody in the spring wanted to ride a bike. And then camping equipment started disappearing. And at that point I was looking for some camping equipment and everything was sold out online. I finally got a toilet. So we found our sweet spot. Who knew that a toilet would be our ticket to freedom? That's what it was. So we installed it into my camper. So I call it a camper. It's my CRV, Honda CRV, that I kind of outfitted for camping or for traveling in a car. So it was like, I was a survivalist. I like bungeed up the seat. I put in the toilet. I tested it out, made sure it was okay. I got a refrigerator. What else? Oh, and then a power station to keep the refrigerator moving or keep it on while we were stopped at various locations. So I was ready to go. So here we go. We're going out on our socially distant road trip this last summer. And you can barely spot the kid in the back seat. That's my daughter. So we selected various points along I-90. It was just kind of convenient, like where can we get to and get to quickly with the limited time that we had. We had more time than a lot of people did because we could work remotely. But we decided to kind of follow I-90, and there's so many great spots all along I-90 that you can hit. So I just hopped on the highway and we went west. And so while in transit, I didn't feel like I had gotten to a vacation until we got past Minnesota. We spent the night there and we went to, we kept driving South Dakota, and we ended up at the Corn Palace. And I've always received friends of mine that had stopped and they'd sent me postcards, but I'd never seen it in person. And what the heck, I'll check it out. So, it turns out that the Corn Palace is turning 100 years old this year. So I think a lot of people are going to be visiting the Corn Palace. I have another video I'll play really quick about the Corn Palace. I didn't go in. I did not want to go into the visitor center. So I stayed outside and then I discovered something really cool.
I helped make the Corn Palace. I made one sack of wheat that's going to go up in the section here that says 100 years. It'll probably go up tomorrow.
Yeah. So all the stuff that isn't brand new gold, you can kind of tell it's kind of faded, was left last year. All the new gold stuff's this year.
Okay.
So we're just doing half of it. So we're just using, with the COVID thing, we just use our part-time staff inside. On a normal year, I'll hire about 13 kids out here.
Kind of a twice a year process then?
Yeah, we do end of May, well, kind of college summer is out. We do end of May till hopefully first week of August, we're done with rye. And then we'll switch into corn whenever it's ready in September, get done mid-November.
You can absolutely make a bundle if you want.
Oh yeah, show me how to make a bundle.
Absolutely.
So just get a kind of a handful, it doesn't matter much on the width.
Then we try to get the ends as even as you can.
Okay.
We cut them with the saw, so don't by all means have to be perfect.
Okay.
Might need a little more. Here, though. Otherwise the ties don't quite go around it.
Okay. All right,
take that one with you?
Oh, no. I want it to be on the wall.
Okay, perfect.
All right, thank you. And then they'll go up today?
I might wait till morning since it's getting hot now.
Oh, yeah.
I put about 3 buckets up this morning, though.
Oh, yeah, that's good. It's like you're baking off the side of the wall.
It's hot when you keep going back.
All right, well, thanks
nice
a lot.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So there were other roadside attractions along I-90, including Wall Drug, which I did not go into. As you can see by the number of cars, South Dakota wasn't very good about wearing their masks either, obviously from that last video clip, but I wore mine. But there were places, there's just places that you probably might want to avoid if you're planning any kind of road trip this summer. And Wall Drug is the perfect example. It was so crowded with people. You see the billboards all along I-90 as you approach. And so it's one of those places that probably shouldn't go in. So we finally felt like we had arrived when we reached the Custer State Park. It's this gorgeous, gorgeous lake. I'm sorry if I'm moving the screen a little bit, sorry. We didn't go kayaking, although we had brought a kayak with us in the car, but it's, Look at those rocks. It's really just amazing. So Custer State Park is kind of a lesser known spot. Like people think of Mount Rushmore in the Black Hills, or they think of the Badlands. They might not necessarily think of Custer State Park first. It's a 71,000 acre park and there's just so much to do there. Hold on. There we go. You can still go to Mount Rushmore, but you might want to rethink when you go. So on the photo on the left, there is a picture of Mount Rushmore midday. There's a lot of people milling around. But on the right, there's no one there. We went at 6 a.m. We got up really early. Now, I'm a photographer. I'm used to getting up early for the sunrise, and I'm used to staying around for the sunset because that's the time where the light is the most beautiful. But also it's less crowded times. So you kind of have the place to yourself. So keep that in mind if you're making a trip to a place that might be really popular. I'm not gonna show you the video because we might be running out of time, but Custer State Park has the Needles Highway. There's the bison on the Wildlife Loop Road. It has the second largest public herd in the United States behind Yellowstone. And every fall they round them up and they sell a bunch of them, and the money goes to supporting the bison in the park. And the Sylvan Lake is part of Custer State Park, and that's kind of where we stayed. That's where our cabin was close by. We could walk around, hiking through the rocks. That was kind of fun. Needles Highway. There's a nice long highway called SD, let's say South Dakota's Route 87. And it kind of winds through this beautiful area with all these rocks and then comes to a point at Needle's Eye. Just gorgeous. Once again, we passed through Deadwood, another town. It was overrun with tourists. We decided, well, what are we going to do? We decided to go to the cemetery and see where some of these notable figures from the Wild West had were buried, including Wild Bill Hickok and Calamity Jane. I guess Bill Hickok, he had been playing poker in an area saloon number 10, and apparently someone shot him in the back, and that was the end. All right, so the next stop along the highway was this place, Close Encounter. I had never been to Devil's Tower before, so I thought I would include it on this road trip. And in fact, one day I was making mashed potatoes and then I started making a volcano out of it. I'm like, oh my gosh, I have to go there. So that's how I ended up in Devil's Tower. I'm gonna skip the video again. And the KOA campground we almost pitched a tent there, but we ended up getting a cabin because it had been raining, and then it cleared up and it was so beautiful, and the view of the Devil's Tower is amazing from the KOA. And then this was the view in the morning. I went down to the river and took some pictures. Allow for some spontaneity on your road trips. I had never heard of Medicine Mountain before. And at the top of the mountain, after you climb to the top of the mountain, there's an ancient medicine wheel that's still in use today. It's been used for Native American ceremonies. And there's like feathers and little packets tied onto the rope that's surrounding it, and deer antlers in the middle. It was just really spectacular. And we didn't even know it was there as we were passing by. Heart Mountain was another one. I was looking for a place to stay near Cody, Wyoming, before we went into Yellowstone. And on hipcamp.com, which is another website that I highly recommend, it helps you find places to camp, but they also have what they call glamping, which tends to be cabins. So I was looking at that and I found this awesome cabin. And at night, the stars were amazing. The Milky Way's right there. The cabin is called a Japanese cabin. And I was like, what? I mean, we're out west. I'm picturing Wild West kind of thing. Why is this themed Japanese cabin in the middle of like the ranch lands of Wyoming? And I found out it was because Heart Mountain was the site of a relocation center during World War II, where the Japanese Americans were sent. So that kind of really changed the narrative of our trip to that spot, even though it was so beautiful. And I couldn't help but think about all the people that were forced there and had to wake up to that view, and like just wondering what they would have thought or what they would have encountered when there was really nothing out there. They lost their homes, their jobs, belongings. So that kind of made me pretty sad. But it was still a beautiful view. I mean, look at that. The guard tower is still there. You can visit the Heart Mountain Relocation Center, except it was closed when we were there, but you can visit their website, and there's great stories about what life was like living there. But they had planted, see, you have the sunflower field here, but they had learned to plant things that no one knew could grow in Wyoming. But the Japanese Americans made use of what they could, and they planted what they could. And so they were able to bring a little bit of home to their horrible living situation. So as we move westward, we hit Cody, and this is more like what I imagine the Old West to be like, less like Heart Mountain, more like the Old West. And we just stopped there briefly. And of course we were headed for Yellowstone. And this is Old Faithful, Grand Prismatic Spring. You can see here that the narrow boardwalks aren't really conducive to social distancing. So I recommend going in the morning. And here's an aerial view of that same spot, but once again, there's more space. Yellowstone's amazing. I don't know how many of you have been to Yellowstone in your lives, but I had never spent so much time there. And it's just really stunning. You can go to the Hayden Valley. You can see beautiful waterfalls. There's two swimming holes where you can sit in the river and swim. And some of the pockets were hot, so it was like a little hot tub there. And then we ended up in Montana, one of my favorite places to go. And we ended up hiking a couple hikes along the Absaroka Beartooth Wilderness, including this river here. And then on the way back, Little Bighorn Battlefield was right there, and I had a national park pass, so we went. And on the way back, we hit Badlands, finally. We didn't hit it at the beginning. And this spot I found just purely by accident, because I spotted some bighorn sheep, and I kept driving up to where all those RVs were, and I see that they're all camping there. It's something called dispersed camping. If you don't know what that is, it's free camping. You can camp in like BLM lands and places where that are designated by the government, and they're absolutely free, but they have no services. You don't get a bathroom. You don't get, anyway, I didn't stay there, but look at that view. I was stunned. It's just gorgeous. We stayed in the cabins at Badlands. Once again, it was a beautiful view. And at night, We could watch the sun go down right in the middle of it. And then we're getting closer to home now. We stopped at the Wisconsin Dells. That was a last minute booking and we rented that boat. And my daughter absolutely loved it. She kept saying, go faster, faster. And she liked swimming in the water. I'm not gonna play that video either. And on the way home, we hit Holland, Michigan. It's kind of like visiting another country when you're not allowed to go to that country. So we hit Holland, Michigan, and then here we go. We may not have time. I mean, I'll go quickly through this and then we can have some Q&As. So plan your route and lodging in advance. Get a satellite view of campgrounds. If you ever stay in a campground out west, you'll know there's not a lot of tree cover. So I always look for places that are at higher elevations with ponderosa pines. And so I looked for the spots. You can see some of the spots that are wide open. I picked some ones in the woods. Purchase a national park pass. Some of you can get the senior pass. The golden age passport is no longer called that. It's called senior passport, but it's great because it allows you entrance into the national parks. And get a toll transponder for tollways, like I-90 uses Easy Pass in Ohio, and there's reciprocity with some of the other spots, like in Chicago, I think it's E-Pass, but there's reciprocity, so you don't have to pay. Otherwise, they'll send you in the mail, I think they send you a bill. Schedule car maintenance, that should get an oil change, get it all done before you go, clean the car. Download Google Maps. I love this feature because there's so many places in the country where I don't get service, including in Ohio. I can get a cell signal on the top of a mountain in Switzerland. I can't get one in Hocking Hills. And then prioritize what you're packing, you know, the stuff that you have to take out first, keep toward the back. And then pack boredom busters if you have kids. You can see that she's kind of enthralled in probably her iPad right there. And last but not least, you don't have to leave to Ohio to have a good time. If some of you are in that area, places you'll love close to home, Hocking Hills. I'm just gonna go through these really quick. These are new geodesic domes at the Inn and Spa at Cedar Falls. They already have yurts, but they just added these this year and I was able to go down and photograph some of the rooms. And I already mentioned Salt Fork. The Wilds is another one of our favorites. You can spend the night. And they had something new this year for the pandemic. You could sleep in a tent in the rhino enclosure. I mean, it's the perfect Jurassic Park kind of experience where the gates come open, they lock behind you, and then you're stuck there overnight. And so you're behind a fence, but you're right there with the rhinos. And that's my view in the morning. Ashtabula County, covered bridges, wineries, Sandusky, trout fishing if you're into that. There's a place called Millsite Lodge that's right on the creek. Columbus, you know, I included Columbus because it's such a great city, but a lot of it, you know, you have to worry about social distancing. I took a fashion class with somebody there. Topiary Park, that's kind of fun. It features the world's only known shrubbery version of a painting. So it's the Sunday afternoon on the Isle of La Grande Jatte. I don't even know, I don't speak French, but it's by Georges Seurat. That's fun. Columbus also has German Village, and this is Schmitz, some crazy stuff there. Cincinnati, Metropole. This is the 21C Museum Hotel, which I absolutely love. And you can't really do this anymore, but you can sleep with the art. Cincinnati, American Sign Museum. Just across the river is the Newport Aquarium in Covington. Islands, Put-in Bay Islands, South Bass State Park. That's my daughter. We're in front of the cabins you can rent. And of course, the way people get around there is by bicycle and by cart. This Middle Bass, Kelly's Island, there's a yurt, they have a couple of them. And just some of the things you can enjoy. Dayton, I really, really enjoyed for the flight history. Now, this is a Wright B Flyer that's run by an organization that restored or recreated one of the, it's the Right Bee Flyer. It's one of the third or fourth version that didn't crash for the Wright brothers. So, and you can fly in it if you pay the $100 fee. Right now they're closed for COVID, but hopefully that'll open up soon. And the National Museum of the US Air Force is fun. Glen Helen. I stayed at this bed and breakfast right near Glen Helen in Yellow Springs. Clifton Mill. I mean, there's just so many great places. David Grohl Alley is in Warren. The Cuyahoga Valley National Park is the only national park in Ohio. Malabar Farm, Serpent Mound, Cleveland's got a lot of great stuff going on, including the Christmas Story House where you can spend the night. Mommy Bay State Park, Amish Country, and Toledo has the new Cannelly Tree Houses in Oak Openings, which are absolutely so fun. And then I wanted to make a special mention of West Virginia because the New River Gorge National Park has just been designated. It was designated after like the stimulus package in December, they became a national park. And this is Bridge Day, which takes place once a year there. Anyway, we're done. I'm gonna stop sharing. If you have any questions, please ask them. I will also certainly turn it over to the Llama Farm folks.
So I think at this point, if you guys have questions you'd like to, first of all, let me tell you, since we're recording this, if we went too fast for you at some place or you want to go back and see some other pictures, you know, again, the recording is going to be on the website at the library. And if you can't find it, just email me. Like I say, it'll probably be up there tomorrow afternoon. You can email me to find out. Also, Laura gave me some resources. And Laura, can I feel free to share that link that you gave me with other people? Because I'm not quite sure how to share that now.
Yeah, we can put it in the chat. Let me see.
So I would just go to mine and like copy and paste it, or?
Yeah, or I can do that really quick too.
Would you? Oh, thank you. It's always nice to have someone who knows more about technology than I do.
So because I was talking fast and I whipped through a bunch of the things, I did include all of the places that I kind of mentioned. I have all the links to, and various links to my book and the trailer for my film and all this other fun stuff. So all the self-promotional stuff, but also all the links to the places that I mentioned today in the presentation. And it's right there. I just
there it is. Okay.
Put it in that. So if you don't want to lose that link, go ahead and copy and paste it and save it somewhere else, because once you close out of Zoom, it will be gone.
And what you could do is you can take a picture of it with your phone on the screen, I guess, or go see the recording, you know, too, then you can get it if you can't copy and paste it right now. So, okay.
Yeah.
Would you talk just a little bit about your documentary, the far flung, the tripped up?
Of course I will.
That was so fun.
Did you watch the trailer?
Oh yes, of course I did. Okay. It was zany.
So there is a guy in Cleveland, his name is Steve Belkin, and he runs a company called Competitors. It's like the Amazing Race for regular people. In other words, if you want a really crazy, fun European trip, he runs them once a year, and it's for like teams of 10, and you and a partner will go and do this competition, and he will send you to 5 different countries, and you do like 5 or 6 things in each country, and it's just a whirlwind act. So it's hard to say it. It's hard to sum up that trip in like 4 sentences, so we decided to make a movie about it instead. So it's like a 77-minute film. And we're in the process of shopping it around right now.
Yeah, it was very fun to watch. Very, very fun.
Thanks.
Yes, Jim, you have to unmute yourself and ask your question. Did I see your hand up, Jim? No. Okay, I thought I saw your hand up. Does anybody else have a comment or a question?
Does anyone want to see more llamas? Raise your hand. Or is everybody just done? Everybody wants to fall asleep. Okay, well then.
Hey, we gave him a chance to talk. Okay. I do think, you know, what I really liked about your presentation, Laura, is that, yes, we all want to get back to some sense of normalcy, but we sure can do that in a safe way. And you've proved that to us. You know, we might have to adjust our expectations of a getaway. But like you say, there are so many beautiful things in our own country and in our own state that really could be a day trip or an overnight trip. We just have to kind of look for those things to do because they're just, you know, they're out there. We just have to set our mind to really wanting to do that. Now, you also, I can see by looking at some of us that maybe we have younger people in our lives that want to do a family thing. And there, I know that some of the folks around town I've been seeing on Facebook, we're on spring break right now. And they are going to, they're enjoying Hocking Hills. I saw someone at the Cuyahoga National Park. You know, so you can do those trips, eat pretty easily and pretty safely. And you can kind of engage in the activities, the amount of activities that you want. You don't have to do everything the park offers, but you can certainly do something. So,
yeah. And once again, you guys are in such a great spot in Dover. You're surrounded by all these great places to go. So you just have to drive 15 minutes down the road and you're in a totally different world.
Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Yes. So, Bill, would you like to show us some more llamas? Are they right there beside you or do you have to walk a little bit to get to them? Oh, wait, he's muted again. Hang on. Let me see if I can unmute him. Wait a minute. Now I don't see how to unmute him.
There we go. Am I unmuted?
There you are. Okay.
All right. No, let's go. Let's go see the kids. Oh, there's Chewy. There's Chewy. He is tired. He's napping. He's napping now. You know, all that excitement and temporary stardom has thrilled him to the point where he needs to sleep. Oh, who's this here? Hi, Jungles. Here we are. Here's Starla Moonbeam. She's wearing her decorative grass, you know, from her mouth there. Yes. What's going on, buddy? Now the thing that's kind of fun about these guys, let me see if I can get a close-up on their, oh nope, not going to get a close-up from her, she's camera shy, but they have rectangular pupils and they see in three dimensions and actually they can see 300 degrees, so the way you want to steer them is you get into their blind spot, you see, and then they have to move to be able to see you. See, she's turning. See, if I go over here, then she's notice she's always got to turn her head to be able to see where I'm going. And that's how you steer a llama. Unless they're totally fearless, like Jangles is. And his sister. The two of them are so cute together. I wish I could get them to play with each other on command, but she's been a very good big sister. And in the winter time, Jangles was born in February. And, you know, when they're born, they don't have any wool to speak of. And it's real easy for them to get hypothermic and die when they're born in winter. So I'd have to sneak up on him every dinner time and grab him from behind. And he'd have all four legs up in the air. And his mother, of course, would follow behind. And we would walk through the gate over here and then into the barn here with the double doors closed and a little insulation put over that. But llamas love to jump up and stand on the fence, which is why, if you notice, my fence has been repaired multiple times. This one is in sad need of repair, just because they're always trying to get each other's attention, especially from the boys' side of the fence. And they're very happy critters. So no other questions? Oh, one thing that's kind of interesting, most people don't know this, they don't have top teeth in the front. Otherwise, they would look just like rabbits, because that's one of the things that sort of happened when they were going from eating trees to, or going from eating grass to eating trees. But also the thing is they live in the desert, so it's a real advantage, because what they do is when they are grazing, they shear the grass off about a quarter of an inch, half an inch from the ground, and they just bite down on their gums with the bottom teeth. You know, let's see if I can get close enough to... Oh, no, they're all running away from me now. They're being camera shy. But the thing is what happens is they don't pull it up from the roots the way goats and cows and sheep do. So it means that they're very gentle on the environment that they live in. And, you know, you were talking about RVs. We have three trailers on the property. And the people that live in this section, of course, have Chewy is a next door neighbor, and he comes and visits. Oh, here's Legs. There's Legs Obama Llama. And he was born. What do you think, buddy? What do you think? He's very photogenic. And he was born on November 3rd, 2012. It's easy to remember his birthday because of his name. And I always wait until two or three days after they're born to name the llamas, because you never know whether they're going to make it for sure or not after they're born. So he's been a real character, and he's pretty funny. He likes to, you know, give you a sniff on the end of the nose. He's a big kisser. He likes to kiss the guests, and he really likes children. In fact, all llamas find children very unique and interesting, because they think small humans are, I don't know, they must think they're cute, just like we think little llamas are cute. They're just like we are, I guess. But yeah, the thing that's been interesting about them, you know, we sheared them at first when they were young, or not when they were young, when we first got the herd. And they running out of power on my phone here. So if I black out, I apologize. But the llamas, when we first got them, we did try shearing them, and their wool is among the warmest. In fact, in Peru, they like the softness of the alpaca, but if they want to make something that's going to keep them warm in the winter, they use llama wool. And we have a batch of yarn coming back from the mill. I think Robin said she was going to pick it up tomorrow. But we stopped shearing them. And the main reason for that is that it makes them much more relaxed around people. They don't think that somebody's going to grab them and cut all their hair off, which makes them much friendlier and much more personable. And you can really sense the uniqueness of each critter's personality. And that's really quite unique, because most of the time we think of animals as just being all alike. You know, all horses are the same, all cows are the same, all goats are the same, all llamas are the same, but they're not. They're just as individual as we are. They have all the same emotions. Part of them that is emotional is identical to the part of us that's emotional. The limbic system is identical in all mammals. And I think sometimes as humans, we forget that they have feelings too. And that's one thing I want people to sense when they come visit us on the ranch is how personable they are and how unique they are. And they have a sense of humor and they find things interesting and funny and they're curious and they're just like us in so many ways. And I think as humans, we need to start realizing that all the animals around us, we need them here. They need to have their place. And that includes the wolves and especially the coyotes. I love the coyotes here. We have a family that lives out in this big field here. I think you can see it. The garden's not looking the greatest right now. Chewy has been redecorating the garden. But out in that field underneath all those junipers during the night, we have coyote families that live out there. But every night they come back from their daily hunts around the Santa Fe River. And there are about 20 of them, maybe more. And they get together for about 15 seconds and they all get together and they sing together. There's just something of their families coming together again that's so heartwarming and so wonderful. And you realize that people that think of coyotes as just like a terrible blight on their chickens because their fences are so badly built that, you know, that the only thing you can do is shoot them. But actually, they're wonderful for us because they keep all the pack rats down and all the... Do you want to say something else, honey?
I don't know who you're talking to.
They're asking questions and I'm commenting on the llamas before the other people that are watching here. Yeah, well, you are on the phone. Yeah, come on out.
And we are kind of running out of time, but it's so interesting.
We are running out of time.
We got two programs for one tonight, really, because we got a special visit to the Enchanted Yurt and Llama Farm in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Awesome, just awesome. And so thank you, Bill and Robin, for sharing. That's really great. And Laura, of course, when we arranged this program, I thought she was just going to be sitting in Cleveland, but no, she told me like, hey, I'm going to be out in New Mexico. Can we shoot from there? And I go, well, of course.
That's right.
Yeah. Cause that's really awesome. So
complete
so
with her Kiva fireplace.
Yeah, really. So I guess we'll kind of wrap up because it's been a wonderful evening and I know, you know, people have things to do or maybe they want to grab the last rays of sunshine, but I want to thank everybody for coming. All of the people who signed in and zoomed in with us. I want to thank Bill and Robin Spencer for sharing their llamas with us. And of course, I want to thank Laura Watilo Blake for presenting a great program that really opens our eyes to the beauty we have close to us and the possibility of getting back to some sort of normal with this.
That's right.
Taking precautions. It's just been an excellent evening. So thank you very much, everybody. And Laura, thank you so much for sharing the way you're traveling with us because it's been very great. It's been very, really, really good.
Thank you,
everybody.
Bye.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Bye.
Have a good evening. Thank you.
Will do. Bye-bye.
You still have lots of hours of sunshine out there. We're at dusk right now.
Oh, yeah. We've still got a 2 or 3 hours.
A couple hours. People here are saying, you know, tomorrow's April Fool's Day, but it's going to get down to 32. People are saying we might have some snowflakes tomorrow. So, Laura, you're in the right place, not in Cleveland, but out there.
Yeah, it's a little warmer, although it's a little brisk.
If you saw from the llama farm, there's snow up on the mountain still. It was last week.
Oh my gosh. Uh-huh. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So we understand cold weather because at night it dips down to like 20s, I would say, right, Bill?
Well, mid-20s now. It's been better. It's at least it's not going into the teens.
So I always think of the llamas and the alpacas as being like mountain like animals in the Andes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So how do they do in the hotter weather there in New Mexico?
Well, you know, the thing that's interesting about the llamas is that they have they perspire through their skin just like we do. And it leaches up into the fine wool right next to their skin and evaporates. And the wool over the top of that area insulates it so it stays cool. See, everybody asks me why, well, how can they get along without being sheared? Well, don't they get hot in the summer? Well, you don't take the insulation out of your roof in the winter, do you?
Right, during
the summer. During the summer, if you want your house to stay cool, you got to have some insulation in the roof. And that's exactly the way they're designed.
That makes total sense.
They're a smartly designed critter.
Yes, total sense.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, well, everybody have a good evening. Thank you so much.
Too.
It's been a wonderful pleasure. Thank you.
Yes. Bye.
Okay. Bye.